So thank you all for being here with us today. We've had a great discussion about some of the issues around early childhood education and what's needed for children and for families in New Mexico. And you have some specific questions that you'd like to take to our state leaders right now. Liza, why don't you start us off?
My name is Liza Gracier. I'm a social worker and I'm also a mother of two. And I would like to refer this question to Mr. Chris Baca. How do we provide all parents at all economic levels the tools that they need, like training, books, parenting, lessons, game activities, developmental screening? How can we get that available to them?
Well, I think we have to do a much better job of reaching out to parents, especially at the neighborhood level. We all know that schools do the best job that they can in terms of imparting this information, but what ends up happening is not enough of the parents that need to be reached are reached. I think we have to have a more active approach to education by involving parents that might not normally be involved in their kids' education. You know, we have a structure in many of our communities. They're called neighborhood associations, and they're there 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. I think if we were to use these organizations that already exist within neighborhoods and use them as an adjunct to what schools are doing and have them be there for parents when the schools are not, of course, not in session or they're out, involve those organizations, I think, in helping distribute information. And that should not be determined by a person's income or economic status. It should be just determined by, do you live in the area? Do you have kids going to school here? And involve them. I think if neighborhoods become more involved, we have that extension of the family that is so badly needed for many of these families that may not have a nuclear structure like a father there or maybe struggling. And I think that would help schools out a lot. It would certainly help out parents.
Chris Muir, is that something that the state could lead as well, giving some support to local municipalities to support those kinds of programs?
I think that the state right now is doing a lot to try to promote parent involvement, especially through the public education department. We've actually had developed a toolkit for parents. We have just recently reassigned staff so that we have a full-time parent involvement person on staff now to really work around that. Parent involvement is key to what happens. Parents are the first educators, and they should be the primary educators of children. And so without the parents being involved, reaching out to the community is critical, as Mr. Baca said. You have to have the parents involved. And one of the things that the schools are really working on with the Parent Involvement Toolkit, one of the components of that is to make schools more welcoming for parents. Schools aren't always welcome to parents. Those of us that are a little older can remember when we were in school, and the only time we went to the principal's office was when we were in trouble. Not that I ever was in trouble, but, you know, and that's how parents view the school. So if they're called in to the school, they're thinking something's wrong, or there's something wrong with me, or there's something wrong with my child, and they're in trouble. And that shouldn't be the reason, the primary reason for parents to be involved in school. And parent involvement doesn't mean just showing up at the school. It means being involved with your child, being involved with their education, being the one that that your child comes to for help, and showing them that you value education. And that's key, I think. And so I think parent involvement and the community, working with the community, working with those resources in the community. We have full service community schools that reach out now, and they look at that parent involvement to things that we wouldn't think of, like churches and those neighborhood organizations. How do we go to where they are versus saying you always have to come to us to make it work?
Do you have a follow-up question?
You just said it. So how can we make it a positive experience for all parents? They don't feel threatened, you know, when they try to find those resources. So, you know, I think that's very important that, you know, everybody, you know, the whole community, legislators and every, you know, all leaders and parents can work together to get those resources available.
And that's another topic that Tony has a question on, that about schools and literacy programs being available to lots of different kinds of families.
Yeah, she Tony Estrada initiate nakai din initially do hashlishni bashichin. I introduce myself Navajo way, and my question is to Eric Griego, and don't worry, it's not Navajo.
Okay. Thank you.
New Mexico is a state of rich heritage, a melting pot of cultures. What can legislatures do to to promote and encourage cultural diversity through literacy programs? And that's to both legislators.
Well, that's a great question. You know, we just had a national report that the Casey Foundation put out on literacy, fourth grade literacy, and sadly, 9 out of 10 Native American kids are not reading at grade level. By far the worst, you know, sadly, other kids of color, and all kids aren't too far behind, but it's clear that Native American kids and Hispanic kids and other kids of color are struggling beyond what the overall population is. So when you look at our public school system, you realize that the overwhelming majority of the kids statewide in this system are kids of color. Many Native American kids, many Hispanic and African American kids. And you also realize that the vast majority of them are Title I kids, meaning they're coming from the 40% of New Mexico households who are single parent households. That's, you know, 2 out of 5 kids are growing up in households that are single parent headed households. So between the economics and the fact that we have a very, very culturally diverse educational environment, it presents a whole other level of challenge. So there have been some great initiatives. There's a specific office for Indian education. We just inaugurated a new office for Hispanic education. Folks who say a kid is a kid is a kid, and they all learn the same, I think don't appreciate the fact that there are unique challenges. For example, to a Navajo kid who grew up in a very rural, traditional environment, and plopping him in a traditional school may not work for that kid, or taking a Latino kid or a Mexican-American kid whose first language was Spanish, and wondering why he or she is not performing at the level of other kids when we're not trying to teach them to learn first before they learn a second language and learn. So those are all challenges that a state like New Mexico has, I think, above and beyond the country. So it's not always about funding. It's about having teachers who are sensitive to this and their training, so investing in teachers and educational professionals. It's about acknowledging that kids are different. There's a lot in common, but kids are different. They learn differently. And it's about, I think, getting back to something I said earlier, is going to the environments that they're comfortable in. Now I was expecting them to be in places and be what the mainstream culture says they should be in terms of how they learn, the language they speak, the kind of books that they should be exposed to, the kind of teaching style that they should be exposed to. So I think it's a big challenge that we have, and I think we're starting to address it, but I don't think we've done nearly enough.
You know, I would say that in addition to the challenges, we also have opportunities in our state. You know, some of the things we need not underestimate is the impact of a quality teacher in the classroom. And so, you know, the research all suggests that the number one predictor of student success is the quality of the teacher. What we have in our state is a great opportunity to grow our own teachers, homegrown teachers from communities that may sometimes be more representative of the communities in which they teach, and therefore connect with students, not just on an academic level, but on a personal, community-oriented level, and allow those students to use those teachers as role models, not just, again, in the academic sense, but for life goals. I think everyone in the room can remember a teacher that inspired you to become who you are today. And I think we need to make sure that we're growing our own teachers locally, that they can invest back in the community from which they came and have an impact on the next generation of learners. So,
Tony, is that something that you see as important? Would you think it would make a difference for kids if, say, there were more Navajo teachers, more teachers from tribes and pueblos?
I really believe that having more teachers, you know, specific to that area, you know, would really help a lot in encouraging education for that community. Thank you for your answers.
Next, a question about investment. Frank.
My question is, investment in early literacy programs have been documented to have a multiplier effect of $6 to $16 per dollar spent, and those figures come out of a study that was done by the Federal Reserve Bank of Minnesota. How can we make this type of investment, early childhood literacy investment, a priority in New Mexico?
Wow, multiplier effects are very often debated in Santa Fe, whether you're talking about film tax credit or you're talking about any number of things. Multiplier effects are a subject of much debate. But I want to put that debate issue aside, and I'm going to say that the question is exactly what we need to be talking about, is where do we invest as a state? And we're talking this today about, you know, investing in early childhood literacy and language acquisition. I think one of the ways that we invest is that we strengthen our colleges of education who are preparing the next generation of teachers. In fact, I want to commend the colleges of education in New Mexico that have actually come together with a legislative working group to look at reading curricula. I was pleased to co-sponsor a House memorial last year that called for that kind of a task force. We're looking at scientifically research-based reading curricula so that it's not just, well, this is what I think works in the reading classroom. We want to know that it works before we put it in place. And we don't want to experiment on our kids. We want to have the very best vetted work that we know will work with our kids. So that's an investment. We improve the teacher preparation programs. Another investment is that we keep class sizes low, not just in pre-K, but also going into the early primary grades where learning to read is still occurring all the way up to the third grade and sometimes beyond. If we start to get in a situation where budget cuts are causing our pupil-teacher ratios to exceed 25, 30, 35 in the primary grades, we're going to doom a whole generation of learners all the way through senior year.
I just wanted to say, I'm glad we're using the word investment, because mm-hmm. when we think of investment, and it's an unusual messenger to have the Federal Reserve Bank weigh in on early childhood right. investment. The studies you're referring to are among a growing number of studies, Perry Preschool Study, the A.B. Sedarian Study, the Chicago Study, and many others, including our own pre-K program, that are starting to prove what is pretty well accepted now, which is every dollar we invest in those first 5 years of a child's life, where 90% of brain development is happening, the return on investment they're talking about is not only the money that we save in things like special education and remedial education and dropout and teenage pregnancy and Medicaid, and it goes on and on, but more importantly, those people, when they become parents and adults and workers, and hopefully doctors and teachers and lawyers, they're paying taxes, and they're helping us build a strong economy. If we do not invest early, then and we think that it's a better investment to build a science and tech park, or a better investment to build a spaceport, or a better investment to build a film industry. And I'm not saying any of those things are bad ideas, but we don't talk about early childhood as an investment. It really is. Right now, we spend about 60% of our state budget on K through 12 and higher ed education. Less than 1% on those first 5 years in the state budget, less than $35 million of state money. That's crazy, considering we know where most brain development happens, and the best investment, and the numbers you're citing are states like Michigan and New Jersey and others that are getting this, realize that they are saving so much money down the road, besides being the right thing to do. You save so much money as a community by not having to have more juvenile justice programs, more substance abuse programs, and more suicide prevention programs down the road, because you've really said, we're going to launch you into the first 5 years of your life into the school system with not just the cognitive skills you need, but with the social emotional skills you need and all the supports you need, nutrition and health. And you're going to succeed. If we have anything to say about it, every kid in New Mexico is going to succeed.
I see a lot of heads nodding out here. I'm wondering if anyone has a specific action that you'd like to ask our panel about here to follow up on that question of funding.
The specific action that I'm referring to is pre-K for all students on a voluntary basis. I've noticed as principal of an elementary school that there's a big difference when the students come in from the economically disadvantaged, or ELL students, English language learners. They really come in behind the eight ball, especially with the poorer kids. And so if we had preschool for all our students, that would give us, we would get the kids reading on grade level by third grade.
Any thoughts on that? Do you think that's something that's possible in the state of New Mexico right now?
I think that right now we have a great pre-K program. It's been evaluated extensively, and basically it is significantly improving the outcomes for the kids who are in the program. That's the good news. The bad news is less than 15% of kids, four-year-olds, which the program services, are in the program. So the funding for the program, which is about $19 million a year now, is it's significant, but it's way below what we need to have. It should be 80, you know, states like Oklahoma have 70% coverage for their programs. So I agree with you 100%. So one thing we can do is just make a decision make a decision that pre-K, four-year-olds, every single four-year-old who voluntarily, not mandatory, voluntarily wants to go, will have a slot. Just like the public education system, you get a slot. Maybe we ought to even include three-year-olds. Now, some of us would argue that we need to start much earlier than that, but if just talking about pre-K, again, it gets back to, I hate to say it, tangible actions, where the rubber meets the road is, are we prepared as a community, as taxpayers, to say, we will make the investment in those kids and every kid having that opportunity.
I'm going to go out on a limb, if you don't mind, and disagree with the Senator. We do this from time to time. That's kind of why we have public discourse. I believe in readiness, and I believe that readiness is going to be a major factor for success down the road for students. I think where we disagree is the extent to which it's the government's role to provide every possible service. And I think there are a lot of folks in New Mexico who say, we've got to do a better job making our kids ready for school so that they come prepared to learn. They come with a lot of those support structures in place. But it's not, again, the government's job, whether it's state government, federal government, or even local or county government. It's not their job to do it. It's the job of communities. And we talked in the beginning discussions about the role of neighborhood associations, and even I think Chris Muir mentioned churches, and their cooperative extension service, which is quasi-governmental. It's funded through the New Mexico State University, but they do some parent training programs to begin modeling the kinds of behaviors that we need to use as parents to prep our kids for success when they get to school. I don't know, it's a slippery slope if we start saying every four-year-old. Well, why not every three-year-old? Well, why not every one-year-old? And do we just take them from the hospital and put them right into government school? And I'm a school educator, I'm a public school educator, but it's a little bit dangerous for us to go down that road, because where's the stopping point? So, thank you.
Representative Rush, do you think that it is a good investment, though, to invest in parent training for, say, brand new parents? Do you think that would make a difference right there?
Not across the board. I think there are certainly subgroups of parents, subsets of parents that don't have the skills necessary. And I think part of that has been the cycle of dependency we've created as a state and as a nation, so that you have. In fact, I'll give you a little quick anecdote to illustrate the point. I spoke recently with a teacher from an alternative school on the eastern side of the state, and she told me that she has a senior student this year who was a senior student in that school last year and could have passed, but the parents told that senior, you need to fail a couple classes so that we can continue to be eligible for public assistance next year. And so we've created a system where maybe we don't want all students to be successful because of family priorities. And so this is going to apply all the way down at the early childhood level, that we've got to be really careful about how we set up a system that incentivizes certain behaviors, because maybe not all parents need that kind of training, and we need to sort of target where those trainings are needed and most effective.
I understand what the representative is saying, but you know, the data is there, and it's just really crushing us right now in terms of the achievement gap and the dropout rate of almost 50%. You know, those, we just, as a society, we can't continue that pace. We have already seen a readjustment in our economic status across this nation, and I think we're seeing it across this the world, as we have an economy that spans countries and not just states or cities. And so we really need to get ahead of this curve. Otherwise, that slippery slope, we're already down that slope.
You know, pre-K has been a priority of this administration, and the intent was to really get pre-K for all to happen. Obviously, we had some economic turnaround, and some of the funding has gone away, but there's still pre-K programs. The evaluations are just phenomenal in terms of what pre-K does. And whether it's the government paying for it or somebody else paying for it, it's needed. And we know that, and I think that we've done something very unique in New Mexico in the fact that we've offered the pre-K funding through both the Public Education Department and through the Children, Youth, and Families Department. And by doing that, we've hit different populations of parents. There are certain parents in certain areas of the state that can access it much better through the CYFD programs. There are other parents that can access it much better through the public school programs. And by doing that, we've broadened. We know that in the public education department programs, we've served just this past year well over 2,000 children. and they are making leaps and bounds, and that's the thing we're seeing. They're seeing increases in vocabulary, seeing increases in their math skills, seeing increases in those kinds of things for children that normally wouldn't have that capability to go to something like that.
I wanted to go back to the ethical question of 1% of our state budget being spent on the first years of children's life, when we know the research on brain development. And I wanted to push it a little from some of the discussion that we were having. This is for you, Chris, and it builds on what you were saying, but others may want to comment. We're concerned that children are undervalued in our society as a national phenomenon. And in fact, the U.S. is one of two countries that has not signed the U.N. Charter for the Rights of Children. With that as the backdrop, who is speaking for children? Where are children's voice? Babies, toddlers, three-year-olds, let alone in their families, for making this shift, this change in investment, let alone getting to the student achievement gap? And our numbers year after year are something that breaks all of our hearts.
Well, you know, I think you're exactly on point there. I grew up in a family of 13, so we didn't necessarily have all the advantages of, you know, being able to go to, and we didn't have kindergarten even in those days. So our parents struggled to just to get us to school and clothe us. And that was a long, long time ago. And unfortunately in my work, and I've been doing this work a long time, we see that same cycle repeated over and over. We cannot deny the impact that poverty has on learning. I mean, if you look at any school that has not met AYP, and which has the lowest test scores, the lowest graduation rates, the socioeconomic indicators are already there. You know, we have not addressed the problems, as you indicate, early on enough. And you can look at whole neighborhoods that are like that. And you don't even have to look at test scores. Just drive through the neighborhood and you'll see that. And our kids are never, and we as a nation are not going to be able to be that great nation that we are and aspire to be unless we make that investment. You know, it's just no other way. Corporations now do, and those that are in the corrections field actually begin building beds or planning for their beds based on three-year-old third grade reading test scores. Now, if they're smart enough to do that, why aren't we smart enough to figure out that we have to counteract that? Because they're planning already on building a $65,000 bed so that they can house that child based on their third grade reading scores. So why is we as a society can't figure that out and make the investment when it should be made is a question that baffles me as well.
It's been a whirlwind public square event, full of lots of great dialogue and ideas about how to make sure every child in New Mexico gets a strong start in learning. But before we can wrap up, we wanted to know what the participants plan to do to move forward. How will they take the conversation that started here in the studio and turn it into action?
I think the next step is to keep the conversation going, keep the dialogue going, keep people interested, keep asking questions, and try to get down to the bottom line of how do we make education a priority. I think that needs to be our focus.
The next step is to follow up on the legislators and how they're going to vote, track what they're doing, and us speak our voice, speak up as citizens.
Yeah, get our communities together, because that's a big part of where it's going to start, is in our communities.
I'm going to work with a bunch of people, a bunch of group business leaders, educators, and others, to try to make the case that we can no longer think of education as beginning in kindergarten, that we've got to start including those first 5 years. And when I say including them, I mean funding them, supporting them.
I think we need investment, infrastructure investment in these communities, whether they're rural or whether they're urban. You know, the investments need to be made at the neighborhood level. And if you see a deteriorated infrastructure, you have to address that.
People have to make it happen. And so it's really building that foundation of the people that can come together, work together, do this in a way. And then we have to have the structure for it to happen.
And if we can find the political will to do it, and as citizens, as elected officials, as taxpayers, if we just make that decision, I think we really can change a whole generation of kids, and we can change the state. This business is working out
okay. We hope you've enjoyed our first Public Square New Mexico in Focus special. We plan to keep up with all of our participants today to see how their plans come together in the coming weeks and months. And we're also busy planning next month's Public Square conversation. The topic will be nutrition and New Mexico's youth. Are you interested in being part of that conversation? Want to make your voice heard? Then we need to hear from you. There's a few ways you can do that. First, you can send us a YouTube video with your take on the most important issues affecting New Mexico's youth. Just grab a camera, record your thoughts, and then head to canami.org to find out how to upload the video to our special YouTube page. You can find the link to the Public Square information page right there on our homepage, knme.org. You can also email us your thoughts at infocus@knme.org or give us a call with any questions you might have at 505-277-1246. That's 505-277-1246.
We look forward to hearing from you.
As always, New Mexico in Focus is your home for involved, informed, and in-depth coverage of all of our state's most important issues. So until next time, thanks for watching and stay enchanted.